Hello explorers and welcome to another video. And today I'm going to talk a little bit about a tool called Keras. And the thing that actually highlighted this video for me was a discussion I had in the comments section with Birin Hoos. I think that's how you pronounce that handle. I'm sorry if I butchered your name. And he tried to actually build a model using sklearn, which is a machine learning made a little bit easier. I realized that setting up a TensorFlow model could be a little bit daunting. So I tried to find something that could do this easy. And my first model that I built in TensorFlow was using pure TensorFlow and was a lot of different parts in it. So it was a bit hard to follow. And I looked at sklearn and what TensorFlow had actually developed around this easier way of building models. And I found sklearn or TensorFlow. And that should be an easier way to build models. But I think that sklearn wasn't really done yet. So you couldn't do scikit-learn and actually get a good model, at least not for deep neural network or an CNN. So with this convolutional neural network that we wanted to build, I wanted to find something that we could do this easier, but with still keeping the same functionality. So I actually found Keras, and I think Keras is some improvements which will make things much easier. So let's look at what the model I built looks like today. So first up, we have this Python file here, where I have this mist data, which I import. I start an interactive session, I have some placeholders, and then I have to set up functions for weights, biases, convolutions, and pooling. And I gave my weights and biases the name W and B, which is something that they actually tell you in the video explaining tensor board, which is something we will look into later to visualize these things. And then I have this reshape of the image to make it into a 28 times 28 little square. And then we start our convolution. So we have the first convolution, the second convolution down here, and then we have a reshape again to flatten the structure before we actually do our fully connected layer. We do a dropout layer, and then we do a fully connected layer again to actually get the result. So this is the last part of this network. And then I actually also set a name for my output tensor so I could easily find them in Java. And I also put this keep probability so you could remove the dropout layer later on. And then we have the cross entropy, which I have given a name. We have the training and some accuracy so we can predict our model and see how well it's doing at the moment. We have the saving of the model with this new save model builder and the actual training steps. And then I write my information to TensorFlow or TensorBoard. So I write the actual graph and all the different information that we saved earlier. And I also save my model. So this is the new steps, all these name scopes, and also this writer to TensorBoard is something that I have added to visualize my model. So if we look into this model that we actually get when we have done all this work, we will get something that looks like this, where we have the input down here with this little node down here, and then we go up to the reshape, which we have a name for. We have the first convolution, which has two variables, the biases and the weights. Then we have the second convolution, two variables there, weights and biases. And then we go up to the flatten construct. We have the first connected layer with weights and biases. We have the dropout, fully connected layer, weights and dropout. And then we have the parts of the training up here. So we have the cross entropy and the accuracy and the output tensor. So this is not a really complicated graph, but it could be a bit hard to follow. And if we didn't name our output tensor up here, we had to go into this last part of the fully connected layer and then look into the last operation in this. So to get our output, we had to look at FC2/add. And I believe that if we hadn't named this FC2, we had to look at matmul2, perhaps, which is the next to last, and then add. So TensorFlow gives every node in the tree a name. And if you don't name them yourself, those could be a little bit convoluted and hard to follow. So by naming things, we have made things much easier for ourselves. And if we go back to the code again, we can also look at the Java model to read and work with this. And pretty much reading the model up here, we prepare some data, we set the input tensor, and we set the keeper probability. And this is the runner where we have input tensor, key probability, get output tensor. So these are pretty easy steps, and I think I talked about all this in the other video. So what's the difference with Keras then? If we go to the Keras model, we actually have a lot of difference here. First off, we have a lot of more things that we initialize. Perhaps we could actually take everything from layers and everything from initializers and so on, but I have picked apart everything that I need. So we start our session and we set the session to K. So Keras knows which session to work on. We have our images and labels. This is the first part, pretty much the same as we had earlier. Now we come to the actual building of our network. And this is where it differs a lot, because this, as you see on screen now, is our network. Fully, every piece of the information that we need for our network. And it's performing pretty much the same. I think the other network performed 99.23 or 36 or something in the new version of TensorFlow, and this performs as 98.99 or something. So they are very similar. I haven't really figured out what part is skewed a little bit different, but I think that's not really important. Because if you can provide very easy easy setup for something that performs really well, then the last couple of percents isn't that important. So in our model here, we have the first reshape into the form we want, 28 by 28. We have the first convolution, and to keep it as the earlier convolution, we need to specify a lot of things. It's a 32 convolution, it has a kernel size of 5.5 and strides of 1. This is pretty much the same as we had in the earlier model, but we also need to tell it which kernel initializer we need, and that was how you set up the actual weights and biases. So this is our weights, they are truncated normal with the standard deviation of 0.1. And we use biases, and the bias initializers are constant of 0.1 as well. So this is all we need to declare for the first convolution. So this is our first convolution layer, and then we have a max pooling layer, second convolution layer, max pooling again, and then we have a flatten operation. So it actually says what it does. So you don't have to figure out that you have a reshape to flatten your structure, and you don't have to figure out how your large structure need to be either. It's just flatten it right off the bat. And then I have my fully connected layer, and they call it the dense neural network. So that's just a difference in name. And it also has a truncated normal and a bias initializer. So you could actually, I think, have these as variables and just supply the same variables for all of this. But I typed it out to make it a little bit more readable. Then we have the dropout layer. Not much to say there. And the last fully connected layer. And I put also this identifier that I had in my other model to tell the network which my output tensor is. So, and then we have the cross entropy down here. Not much to tell there. We have the prediction, accuracy prediction. We have the saver, which we had in the other model. We initialize our variables. We read our input data. We do all the training. We save all the information for our graph. We write out the information for the Keras board. And last, we do a final accuracy check to see how well we did our training against the test data. So let's go over and look at the model in TensorBoard. And this model is a little bit different. It's much easier to follow, I think. We start down here, we have the input tensor, then we have a reshape, first convolutional network, a max pooling, second max pooling, flatten, fully connected dropout, and second fully connected, and the output tensor. And then you have some parts up here. And I think those are actually the things that I didn't name. So those are from the TensorFlow model. So if I give names to all the last parts with the cross entropy and so on, I think you will get some nice boxes up here as well. But I think the part that is really interesting for this network is to actually follow how your network is structured. So the part where you train your network is not that important, because I wanted to see that my network stack was the same. The rest I had copy-pasted from the other model. So I think this is a really nice interpretation of the same network. So Keras does a really good job of making it both easy to write and easy to follow in TensorBoard. So the last part I want to talk about is how do we do the actual representation or training in our Java application. And in Keras, if we look at the model again, we have some part of the training where we say that this is the learning phase. So we say K learning phase 1. And this is a little bit different. Because when you are testing accuracy, you give the learning phase a 0. So that's a Boolean telling it if we are in the learning phase of the operations or not. And that will actually trigger how to handle dropouts and so on. Lastly, if we look at the differences, if we're running either the Java application for the TensorFlow model or the Keras model, and Keras is running on TensorFlow, so but in here we load our Keras model and then we load in the images exactly the same way that we did in the other model, but there's a difference here. The key probability in our Java application for the standard TensorFlow, then we had a key probability that was actually a large array of floats, which all the values were set to 1, keep everything. But in this model, we actually have a learning phase variable that we set to Boolean false. So in this model here, we see that we have the input tensor, and on the dropout layer, we have Keras learning phase and this Boolean false. So we can actually call this learning we can call it no learning, and set that to the learning phase here. So we just set the value into the layer of dropout learning phase and tell it that this is not in the learning phase, so dropout should not happen when we are running this model. And this is pretty much the only thing that you need to change. Instead of having keep probability, you have this dropout Keras learning phase instead. And my guess is that this Keras learning phase is something that you can set either for all your dropout pieces of your network, or you can put it for the whole network as settings. But that's pretty much the only thing that you need to change in your Java code, and you will be off running. So I hope that you found this information interesting, and I hope that you know a little bit more about how this network works, perhaps, and how to use Keras to make your network a bit simpler and to get started a bit faster with the TensorFlow. And if you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below. And yeah, hope you learned something, and I really hope to see you in the next one.